The assembly will now hear an address by His Excellency, the Right Honorable Tony Blair, Prime Minister, First Lord of the Treasury, and Minister for the Civil Service of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland.
Mr. President, colleagues, the challenge for the UN is the same as for all of us: how to respond to change. It must become better organized, better managed, with the direction fit for the awesome tasks it faces. Fortunately, we have a Secretary General who speaks to us with great wisdom and candor about what must be done and is leading a UN ready to reform. We, the member states, must match his vigor. I want to talk about one aspect of reform: peacekeeping operations. Today, colleagues, the United Nations struggles to cope with the new types of peacekeeping operation which current conditions demand. Whether in Africa, East Timor, or the Balkans, it is no longer good enough to organize blue helmet operations as if they were still largely geared to marking an agreed ceasefire line between two states that have consented to a UN presence. The typical case is now fast-moving and volatile. The appalling attack on UN staff in West Timor is demonstrating this for us vividly. I am proud of the role that British forces play in UN operations, not least in Sierra Leone, where British soldiers are still held hostage today. As we work for their release, we should pay tribute to the courage and commitment of all our forces in UN missions right round this world. But UN soldiers need to work within a system better geared to dealing with the demands placed upon them today. We need UN units appropriate for more robust peacekeeping that can be inserted quickly rather than whatever the Secretary General's staff has been able to gather from reluctant member states. This means a new contract between the UN and its members. We must be prepared to commit our forces to UN operations. The UN must alter radically its planning, intelligence, and analysis, and develop a far more substantial professional military staff. The Brahimi report is right. We should implement it and do so within a 12-month timescale. My second point, colleagues, concerns Africa. There is a dismal record of failure in Africa on the part of the developed world that shocks and shames our civilization. Nowhere are more people dying needlessly from starvation, from disease, from conflict. Deaths caused not by acts of fate, but acts of man. By bad governance, factional rivalries, state-sponsored theft and corruption. Nowhere are more people being left behind on the wrong side of a growing digital and educational divide, children being denied the opportunities that will transform the lives of children elsewhere in the world. Yet 30 years ago, the same depressing analysis might have been made of parts of Asia or Latin America. There can be change. There can be hope for Africa. There is political leadership, business opportunity, and above all, surely, will on behalf of the people for a better future in Africa. We must be partners in the search for that change and that hope. By the year 2004, under the new British government, we will have increased our aid budget by 70% since we came to office, much of it going to Africa. Yet individually, none of us have the decisive impact. We need the economies of scale. We need the political will to broker change that only comes by combining our efforts. So, we should use this unique summit for a unique purpose: to start agreeing a way forward for Africa. For the first time, we have in one place here the leaders who hold Africa's destiny in their hands. I urge you all to ask one thing. What can we do for Africa? We need a new partnership for Africa in which Africans lead, but the rest of the world is committed, where all the problems are dealt with not separately, but together in a coherent and unified plan. Britain stands ready to play our part with the rest of the world and the leaders of Africa in formulating such a plan. Colleagues, this is the time to renew the United Nations, and this is why. Our brief speeches may not change the world, but is it still not better that we are here talking to one another rather than fighting each other? The sentiments we express here may often be the same, but at least they are the same sentiments of unity and peace and hope and cooperation. We may be frustrated sometimes by the way the United Nations works, but at least for all its imperfections, it is a force for good, and our desire is that it does more, not less. If the UN did not exist, we would be forced to invent it. Finally, I do not wish to leave the UN without saying this. The treatment of Aung San Suu Kyi by the Burmese regime is a disgrace. I call upon the Burmese government to let her go free, and I call on fellow world leaders to back that call. Thank you.